The BS Report is a free-flowing conversation that occasionally touches on mature subjects.
The BS Report.
The BS Report with Bill Simmons.
Welcome to BS Report. Taping this on a Wednesday. America's been waiting for it. They've been clamoring for it. For 4 weeks, they've been asking, where is it?
Right.
I'm talking about the Fast Six Pod. It's become one of our franchises, Adam Carolla.
Yeah, this is what, sadly, probably what I'm going to be known for.
Yeah, one of the things. Man, no, show, probably Fast and Furious pods.
Yeah, but not even in that order. You know, because it is one of those things where Agnes Moorehead was a great star of Broadway, but we only know her as Endora from Bewitched. All those guys from all those bad, hokey game shows from the 70s that we used to watch, you just know that guy from that. You don't realize this guy was an acclaimed actor in the 40s and the 50s. Right. And he's
so that's us, you're saying?
No, that'll be me. Oh. You'll be fine.
No, I think it's both of us.
Okay. Yeah, so
Fast and Furious, another one comes out. People want to hear us break it down. I mean, they take it very seriously. What's weird is the movie itself has figured out a way to operate. It's entertaining, and they're trying genuinely hard with it, but they're also always very aware of the stuff that people like you and I enjoy about it.
Yeah.
They put the right things in place. They have the right speeches at the right times, and they're always thinking about it.
I was joking about The Rock's arm butter for a year and a half since Fast Five. They had to halt production because he ran out of arm butter.
It was a big running joke for you.
It was a big running joke, and then in the middle of Fast Six, they make an arm butter joke about The Rock.
It's amazing. All right, well, we're going to talk about that in a second, but we want to talk about your new business venture.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's called Road Hard. It's
That's
a
right.
movie.
Independent.
You are adopting the model of crowdsourcing for
yes.
funding.
Yes.
Fundanything.com. You're trying to get to $1 million.
Mm-hmm.
You are now you're about $620,000 away at the time where we're taping this podcast on a Wednesday. And you were hoping to get get about 300 that first week or so.
Yeah.
Seems like you're on pace.
Yeah,
people are giving you money to make a movie.
It's totally insane, and it's weird because people do the, why don't you pay for your own movie? I don't think I would make this movie. It's been 7 years since I made my last movie. Like, I just wouldn't make it. It's too big a hassle. It's too expensive.
Well, you ended up paying for some of the last
one. I ended up paying for a lot of it.
Yeah.
And I didn't get any of the money back, and I ended up begging for money, too, and I ended up, I was just telling someone this today. One of the places I went was Fox Atomic, and it was like Fox Searchlight. And there was a woman there named Debbie who ran a Comedy Central, and she used to refer to me and Jimmy as her son.
Mm.
She loved me. She'd say, yo, you're my son. And even her husband, who is a little bit unemployable, we gave a job directing on The Man Show.
Right.
So, of course,
you felt like she owed you one.
When I had my last movie, I said, let's go talk to Debbie over at Fox Atomic. I'm her son.
Yeah.
And she owes me for her husband. And we walked in there, and she's like, yeah, thanks, but no thanks. And then they went on to make a movie called The Comebacks, which starred David Koechner and Carl Weathers. And you guys can look it up on Rotten Tomatoes if you like. One of the worst movies made in the last 10 years.
You took that personally.
Well,
you like David Koechner.
I like Koechner a lot, but so much for making a movie in this town. You can't get someone that looks at you as a son to make a movie. And instead, by the way, they made a piece of crap, a horrible, horrible movie. She made a horrible decision. The movie made no money. But the point is she's not going to work with the guy she worked with for 4 years from The Man Show. She's going to go work with these other guys and make a piece of crap movie.
And your movie was critically acclaimed. People liked it.
Yeah.
It has a very good Rotten Tomatoes score.
It's certified fresh on Rotten Tomatoes. So
I don't know what that means, but it sounds great.
If you get enough good reviews, they give you certified fresh.
Oh, congratulations.
And I got
Sports Illustrated Sports Movie of the Year.
Right. So the point is I don't want to go through that again. I don't beg dumb people to make my movie.
Brad Mulcahy even said, it wasn't that bad, which is high praise from him.
I really did he say that? Don't tease. High praise.
So you came up with a great title for this one.
Yeah.
And I could picture you guys sitting in a room. you drinking coffee, trying to come up with titles, and then you came up with Road Hard and then probably cackled for the next 10 minutes.
The whole thing was completely organic in the sense that, again, it had been many years since I'd made my last movie. I had no plans on making a movie, podcast, writing books, traveling, doing shows.
You're away every weekend.
Yeah, I don't even know where the time or I'm going to find the time.
You've stayed at every Red Roof Inn in America.
Oh, yeah. No.
Thanks to your booker, Mike August.
No, Mike August is like, is there a brown roof? And they're like, no, just red. No brown. Am I making that up? Yeah.
Poop brown.
Yeah. He's the guy over at the store going, just the top ramen?
Yeah.
There's no bottom ramen at all? Not even, are you out of bottom
even
ramen?
Cheaper ramen?
We left Denver. I did a show in Denver. I'll get back to this. But I did a show in Denver. They put us up at like luxury condos, like the theater, the room put you up in these condos. And when we're walking through LAX on the way back, Mike proudly unzipped his duffel bag, opened it up to me, and in his mind it was like that it was kind of like that scene when they opened the briefcase in Pulp Fiction.
Oh yeah, and the light's gonna come out.
Yeah, except for this was just toilet paper. This rolls of toilet paper. Anyone, huh? Crazy like a fox, huh? Yeah,
and I said, like $3.
What? What is that? It's 18 rolls of toilet paper that he stole from the condominium they're staying in.
Smart.
I said, that's $3 worth of toilet paper. You just had a lug from Denver. And say,
You're talking about the same guy who he figured out a way to propose to his wife with an engagement ring that was sponsored by Jimmy Kimmel Show.
Right. He did a trade out.
Got like a $40,000 ring. Didn't realize that he had to pay taxes on it.
Got screwed.
Ended up paying more on taxes than he would have had he gone to like Koreatown and bought some knockoff ring.
He would have paid $3,000 for a ring.
Instead, generous.
All right. Yeah. $2,200 for a ring. Instead, he got what he thought was a free ring for $40,000 and had to pay $12,000 worth of taxes.
One of my favorite stories ever.
So, I was not going to make a movie, and then this life, this going on the road, this experience started to creep in, and I started talking about making another movie, and Road Hard just came out immediately, just sort of came out of my mouth. And
because you're not really a stand-up comedian, but you're kind of a stand-up comedian now.
Yeah.
You're going to shows, you're on the road, you're living the same life as, say, Jim Gaffigan. Dan Cook maybe is not a great example.
Well,
he's probably selling out 18,000 seat stadiums and staying in suites.
Oh yeah. Oh, by the way, August 3rd, Wiltern Theater.
Bill
was with me last time we played.
Yeah, Jay Moore is around this time, right?
Yep.
I'm available if you need me.
You want to come by? Yeah, say hi. Listen,
I'm available.
So here's the thing. I realized in life, the hardest thing in life is to step backwards. If you're making $12 an hour and you get a raise to $14 an hour, you're pretty happy. But if you get dropped back to $10 an hour, it's brutal. It's not so much where you are, it's going backwards. I mean, I had a radio year where I got $3 million plus in 1 year, and the next year I got $1 million. And it was brutal.
Yeah.
Even though I'm making $1 million to do radio, which nobody should shed a tear for me, I felt horrible because it was a step that way in the wrong direction. And nobody wants to do that in any facet of life. And so this movie is sort of about all these guys that had these film careers, these sitcom careers. They used to have these things called holding deals where they just give you $1 million and they go, just sit still. Like stay at home. And then they'd give you another $1 million for a development deal. So it's like while you're at home, if you think of something funny, you could write it down. Or
just throwing checks at them.
They just literally, they go like, you're a stand-up comedian. We need the next, you know, Seinfeld or Everyone Loves Raymond. And everyone just came in and everyone was like young and looked good and wasn't fat and wasn't bald and all kinds of money. And then they got married, they got divorced, they went through Betty Ford, rehab, what have you. Now they're all in like their late 40s, early 50s. A lot of big names, a lot of guys you grew up seeing on TV and stuff like that. And they're all having to go back on the road. And there's no more holding deals. Everything's just reality TV and Honey Boo Boo and loggers and ice road truckers and everything. And these guys have to go back to the same clubs they swore they'd never play again on the way up, basically.
So it's almost like in the NBA, after you've had your superstar contract and then that tail end of your career when you're a role player again.
Right.
You're getting like Antoine Jameson, you're getting like $1.9 million for 1 year. Like he'd signed an $87 million deal at one point.
My wife, Lynette, used the exact same analogy when I was talking. Yes. Yeah, when I was talking about Road Hard. She said it's like the Antoine Jameson situation.
Yeah, yeah, great point.
So I don't know if you got that from her or maybe you read her Twitter. But this is worse. This is like going and playing in a European league. This is like playing in a Croatian league.
Oh, that's a good point.
Leaving and coming to L.A. and going, I'm never going back to that place again. And now you're back.
And bands, I guess, would be like this, too. Oh, like, you have the bands that hit it big. Now they're playing at, like, some 800-seat arena.
I play a lot of theaters, and I see these posters for, like, the specials are playing with the B-52s or something. And I'm like, first
special
off.
Special guest Devo.
Right. There's one of me, and I'm barely getting paid enough. Yep. There's 11 guys in that band. I don't know how they're getting.
And they're splitting it with three other bands.
Right. I don't know how they're doing it. But yes, literally, I was talking to Mark McGrath of Sugar Ray, and he said, nicest guy in the world. But I said, you know, how's it going with Sugar Ray? You know, because when I was on K-Rock, and it was the late, mid-90s. I mean, Sugar Ray was like one of the biggest bands out there. And Mark McGrath's like the hottest heartthrob out there.
He had a nice run.
And he said...
it's like Macklemore now.
He said, well, we're doing a lot of state fairs and stuff like that. And I said, oh, well, there you go. And he said, any place you smell funnel cake... we'll be there. And I was like, I laughed, but I thought, it's sad that you're playing a state fair, but everyone has to go through it. You see it in sports all the time.
You laughed and then you took the line for your movie.
Right. So I thought, wouldn't it be interesting to chronicle all these guys? Like, you know, Bobcat Goldthwait, he's going to be in Addison, Texas for 4 days.
Right.
He's miserable.
Richard Lewis.
He's got to do the voice, you know.
Yeah.
They all had TV deals and sitcoms and blah, blah, blah. And they're all back. And then the ironic part is they all have to show up to town a day early because the promoter wants them to do local radio.
Oh, yeah.
You know, so they go fly in a day earlier. Now, you do one show Thursday night, two Friday, two Saturday, one Sunday, but they want you to get you there on Wednesday so you can do morning radio.
And there's nothing worse than, like, the local morning radio people at the 58th biggest market.
Oh, wearing fat guys in hockey sweaters.
Worst humor on the planet.
And they're doing this. What brings you back? Why are you doing the clubs? You're away for like 15 years. And then you got to go, I miss the electricity of the live crowd. But it's really like you have an alimony payment and Hollywood's not knocking anymore.
My house has been repossessed.
And for me, I'm taking it a step further because my character does kind of mirror myself in that I had a successful TV career with a partner like Jimmy Kimmel, and he's gone on to be the king of late night. And not only do I get the...
So you're saying you're like the Andrew Ridgely of,
of comedy TV? Exactly what Lynette
said. The Art Garfunkel?
Yeah, so not only do I have to go back on the road and go to these little crappy clubs I started off in, but every morning show interview does the, hey, your buddy's tearing it up, man.
Right.
Well, that's awesome, right? Can you get this? And
see, I think you're doing much better than that.
Well, I'm not... It doesn't mirror it exactly.
You're one of the podcast pioneers now. You made a lot of money.
Well,
You own like 8 Paul Newman cars.
I am saying
you have people that work for you.
Six, how dare you.
Six, I'm sorry.
But I'm saying what if?
So this is an exaggerated, like, what if you were doing worse?
It's an exaggerated version of what if I got divorced.
Lynette leaves you for somebody in Springsteen's band. I don't know who.
Right.
Maybe Springsteen.
I'll listen. She'd take a roadie. She'll go into the second ring strat outside the band. She won't go into Teamster, but she'll step. She told me there's the nucleus. That's the band. That's who's on stage.
Everyone's available.
She'll go to anyone who has the laminate who can get on stage.
There's a pass. Okay.
Yeah. So where guitar tech, you know, what have you.
What is he like 65 now?
Bruce.
Remember when we, like 20 years ago, everybody thought it was so funny, the joke about how the Rolling Stone, imagine them 65 still touring.
Right.
And all these people are 65 and they're still touring.
I know.
It's amazing.
I know. He has a new
The Rolling Stones were here. They were playing at Staples Center like 2 months ago and thinking like, who would go see the Rolling Stones right now?
I don't know, but
what human being would do this?
I decided they would be the best band for you to be a backup singer for.
Because they don't sing or play instruments anymore?
No,
because
they're so damn skinny.
Oh.
That they'd all see you. You know what I mean?
Oh, interesting.
No one in that band is wider than 9 inches.
Yeah.
And they're white as ghosts, and they're skinny. They're like popsicle sticks, you know?
Right.
Everybody. I mean, you know, you go, you know, Mick Jagger's a skinny guy, but Ronnie Wood's skinnier. Like,
right.
So if you're a heavy set woman of color and you're wearing a big dress and you're back there on a riser, you're really
jumping
the star of the show.
You're
popping.
I didn't think about that.
You don't want the husky, you know, you don't want Blues Traveler out there.
You're going to follow John Popper?
Hey, what's going on? Or BTO or some, there's some husky bands out there where you just can't see around the dude. You'd be staring at John Popper's ass crack the entire show, you know?
One more thing about Road Hard. Great title. I'm going to say it again. Great title. Really, really strong title. You know, I love good titles.
Yeah.
You're co-directing this.
Yes.
With our friend Hench.
Right.
Neither of you have directed.
No.
But, seems like you would need a director for a movie.
Well, you know.
I'm just throwing the question out.
And it's a fair question, Bill. I'm prepared to answer.
I've seen you direct or, you know, kind of tell the director what you wanted to do for some of the comedy bits we shot way back when.
Well,
this is an hour and a half.
I've realized I have been directing and editing just about everything I've written.
Always just take over whoever's...
At the man show, it was like, hey, here's how we're doing it. And I remember one time, one of the most... more popular bits I did is when I tried out for the Raiders a million years ago, and the director, Tom Stern, literally was sick like that morning, couldn't make the flight to the Raiders training camp. And I just went, all right. And I just directed.
Was he sick or was he sick?
I don't know, but it wasn't there.
Okay.
And so I just went, oh, we will have no director and I'll do it. And then my last movie, I was the one going, no, here's what we need and here's how this is going to work. And then I just realized.
Well, what did you have the director called Boxing Gloves? What do you call him?
We had a gay director to do our boxing movie.
Not that gay people.
Not that they can't direct. Nice.
Or not that they don't know boxing, but this particular guy didn't know boxing.
Not huge in the gay community, but he didn't know anything. So he'd like say stuff like, if you're going to go in the ring, should you be wearing your boxing hat? And I'd be like,
hey, boxing hat,
headgear, and he'd go, yeah, that's what I said. I said, no, you said
boxing hat.
Like it was like, so I realized me and Hench.
Didn't Mickey call it a boxing hat in Rocky II?
So I realized we just ended up directing the film anyway, and then you end up arguing with the director,
right,
and you waste a bunch of time, and then you end up editing it yourself anyway. You don't actually edit it, but you stand behind the editor and you sit in the bay all day. So I just realized, let's do it.
Big extensive track record in porn of the actors eventually directing.
Mm-hmm.
So that's probably your best case scenario here.
That's right. Moving from the fitted sheet and onto the
behind
director's
the scenes.
Chair.
Yeah.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Once upon a time. Mm-hmm. Well, I'm excited for you. So you're filming
Thank
in
you.
December.
Yeah.
All right. And you think you're going to raise the million?
I think we should.
You're on pace.
We're on pace.
Didn't somebody tell you if you got to 300 within a week, you were going to make it?
Yeah, they have these algorithms, but I have no idea how they work, and it's a little different for everyone. And for us, you make a video, and we decided to make this one with Bryan Cranston.
It was good.
And I just want to make one that was funny, not one where we like...
I caught up on Breaking Bad.
Oh, yeah. He's unbelievable.
He's unbelievable. It always used to make me mad that Ham didn't win the Emmy.
Yeah.
And then I watched all the Breaking Bads. So I was like, oh, I get it.
You even see him do this 4-minute video with me and you realize just how much range he has and just how unbelievable he is. So I just wanted to make a funny video, and you can check it out at fundanything.com/Adam, by the way. And or I think we'll have a link to your site, too. And you go, oh, people are going to give you money to make this movie. Well, no, they stage it. It's like $25. You get the script, and $35 you get a Blu-ray and the script, and $55 you get a T-shirt and a Blu-ray, and it just keeps going like all the way down.
How much money do you have to pay to see August Johnson for 10 seconds? Is that like $5,000?
People just think we stole it from Wahlberg's trophy
from
case.
The end of Boogie Nights.
Yeah. By the way, I don't showing a fake wiener versus a real wiener. If the fake wiener is supposed to look like a real wiener,
why didn't they have a stunt wiener?
I'm just saying, why you couldn't show a real wiener, could you?
I always wondered if the person who was working on that.
That wiener's going to show up on eBay one day, right?
Right.
It's got to show up on eBay.
It probably has already. Huh. The other thing I was always wondered in Silence of the Lambs, when Miggs threw what he threw at Jodie Foster.
Yeah.
How they made that. Mm. Like the stunt guy was like, hey, Bob.
Yeah.
We have a scene today with Miggs and
yeah, the props guy.
Props guy. We need a.
Yeah.
I don't want to bring you down this road. Because
what I'm saying is if somebody comes to you with that request, like, here's what I need from you. Don't jump on it. Don't go, oh, it's just tapioca and Dijonnaise. Right. You got to go do that thing where you go, I don't know. I've never thought about that.
Tapioca and Dijonnaise.
I mean, don't have an answer ready. You know what I mean? Because people think you're weird, you know? There's a lot of those moments I've had in life where, like, people bring up something. Like, do you see this movie or did you hear about that? Or what do you think? And it's a good idea, even if you know, to go, oh, someone did that? They filmed that? Oh. No, I should check that out. You may have seen it 275 times on
the 7 seconds of non acknowledgement.
True story. At the dinner table, my grandmother asked if anyone knew what a rim job was. True story. At the dinner.
Why did she even have that word in her head?
She worked at the Veterans Administration. With veterans.
Oh.
And in like an encounter groups.
Oh, no.
And they spoke about their various problems.
Oh.
Some sexual.
It's always tough when the grandparents.
Someone brought that up and she didn't know what it was. So she put it out to the table.
That's brutal.
To the dinner table. And I did this move where I was like.
Basketball.
My hand was about to fly up. And
it's
then,
a basketball.
Yeah, yeah. Race. And, then, yeah, it's, and I just went. I thought, you know.
Larry Bird created it.
Don't say anything.
All right.
What good could come of this?
Time to switch to Fast and Furious.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
They've been showing the other five a lot.
Yeah.
I know you've noticed.
Oh, yeah.
I know I've noticed. Especially I've been home for the last 2 weeks just detoxing from NBA playoffs and being on the road and trying to feel like a human being again. I've watched a lot of the Fast.
Yeah, me too.
I skipped three. I don't watch three.
Oh.
I need to have Walker and or Diesel in my Fast and Furious.
Yeah, the Tokyo Drift one just... Yeah.
People like it on its own merits, but...
Listen, I don't want to call you out, but Diesel does show up at the end.
It's a cameo, though.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Two, I think, has gained steam a little bit.
What do you think, by the way, when Diesel's agent said to him, like, look, we're going to give you they're going to give you $5 million for a cameo. Do you think his answer was, I don't drive that car? Or do you think he knew what a cameo was? I think Vin Diesel may think that's a type of car.
Oh, he thought it was like a Pontiac?
Maybe a Toyota. I don't drive cameos.
You know what he definitely did?
Mm.
He did the Vin Diesel thing, which in Fast 6, they did 3 different times, I counted. He's mastered the slow-mo look, this thing where it's not going to sound good on a podcast, but it'll sound good on video, where he does the, like, say something like, blah, 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 we got to get him. He does a...
Yeah, he does the
slow. You know
slow
he does
look.
That?
Yeah, he does it.
Nobody else can do it. It almost feels like they slowed him down, but they didn't. That's actually how he turns to people.
Well, it's a couple things. These guys' eyebrows are getting thinner and thinner and thinner. You know what you need to do? Get everyone's eyebrows from the first one and just see them eroding.
You think Vin Diesel, it's like the beach in Nantucket. It's eroding backwards.
Yeah, you know they do that thing where it's like if you watch some Al Gore documentary, they'll show a polar ice cap.
Yeah.
And they'll show the polar ice cap from outer space and they'll say, this is 1985.
Yeah.
Now let's go to 1990. You see it receding.
Yeah.
You'll see all those guys, they're all getting manicured up top around the brows. The thing with Diesel, I can't figure out whether I love or hate the way he drinks beer. He holds the thing way. This weird tilt where it's like he doesn't want to bend his head back. But he tilts the bottle without tilting.
It's like watching actors who don't know how to smoke.
Yeah, like holding the cigarette with their fist or two hands. Yeah, it's a weird thing. Like, I don't think he drinks beer. If he does, he does it out of a stein or a boot or a helmet or something, because he doesn't move.
I don't think
he tilts
beer.
His head forward and makes a V. It's like head goes down and the bottle goes up.
Well, they always have this scene where he's...
Him and Walker always have to have a beer at some point. After
he's always like on a deck or he's on a porch or he's looking out on a mountain.
Yeah.
And I think the director puts those in intentionally because it's a running joke for watch. We got to put a scene where Vin drinks a beer.
Yeah, we got to show him drinking a beer. He's got to be stressing family. He, by the way, killed five people who have families.
I didn't want to get to Fast Six yet, but family.
Yeah.
Family was a big, I would dare to say the Godfather 1 family wasn't as big of a theme as it was in Fast 6.
Huge issue
but,
over there.
You know, before we get to Fast 6, though, which of the five do you think has aged the best on cable? I mean, like Fast 5 is the most rewatchable.
Mm-hmm.
But I really enjoy Fast 1.
Yeah, I like Fast 1.
I think Fast 1 is just a marvelous beginning to end action movie.
Well, it was also like
great ending too.
It was like a 100-minute commercial for NAS. Mm. Like it was like just a commercial for nitrous oxide because every 10 seconds someone was just reaching for some secret compartment that had nitrous oxide in it.
When I saw it in the theater and I really liked it, and I remember it was one of those movies you just got in your car and I saw it in Boston. I was still living in Boston. I drove home like 120 miles an hour. I was like so fired up to get in the car and drive somewhere, but. I remember being like about 30% angry that they had just ripped off Point Break so blatantly.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. Yeah, yeah. I mean, they weren't even trying to
Blonde
make this.
Guy.
It was, undercover, falls on the wrong side, lets him go at the end. I mean, it was all the same beats. But I've gotten over that over the years because I love Point Break. It's a great movie. Rip it off all you want, I say.
Yeah, it's a good
more
point.
More action movies. Like, there's more things for me to watch.
Yeah, it's like a great strip club. So open a franchise by my house.
You should have. I mean? That could have been a possible plot for Roadhard.
Mm.
FBI agent goes undercover to learn from.
That's one of Keanu's greatest moments. I am an FBI.
Oh, yeah. Unquestionably.
Yeah, I know
that's his best movie.
There's got to be takes of him going, I am a BF. Cut. Keanu. Keanu. What? It's FBI. Oh, I got it. I am an IBF. Scott, can I try it one more time? I'm an FI. Oh, damn. Could someone give me a prompter?
I thought his football scenes have really held up in that movie.
I love the scene where it's a moonless night in the middle of Zuma Beach, and one of the stoner big wave surfers comes up to him and goes, Johnny Utah? I saw you playing the Gator Bowl in 87. It's like, really? You recognize the guy out of his uniform?
It's pitch black. And the guy said 40 bong hits.
And nothing, and nobody, 20 beers, and no one knows less, ironically, about sports than surfers. Surfing is a sport that if you do it, you know nothing about any other sport.
Yeah.
I'd like to find the sport, Bill Simmons, that knows the most about other sports. Meaning,
interesting.
You know, do golfers know more about basketball? That you know, I'm trying to think of like who that is. But surfers
are going to be.
They
the bottom
don't know
of
us. They don't. They would not know who Joe Namath.
Probably
was.
Golfers, because golfers have a lot of spare time.
They got a lot of TV time.
Yeah, they're in hotel rooms. They're traveling. Maybe tennis players.
And I feel like they're keeping it real with their caddy. You know, they don't want to seem like old fat white guy. Who's that? I never heard of LeBron.
How about this new LSU coach?
Right. Yeah, they got that going.
Point Break was great. So Fast 1, I think, is really held up. And I think the ending's great. And I love the part when Vin Diesel's in the car after they get by the train. Mm-hmm. And then he gets in an accident.
Yeah.
And then he's in the car. He's like.
Yeah. Yeah, he's doing
then gets out. There. Paul Walker gives him the guy. I like Paul Walker.
I like
him too. Actually not sure why he hasn't become a bigger star.
I don't know. You know, we both love the football movie there at the
Varsity Blues.
Varsity Blues.
Oh yeah.
There's something that's interesting. After the fatality or a couple fatalities in drag racing, it's no longer a quarter mile. It's 1,000 feet.
Yeah, but that doesn't sound as good.
I live my life 1,000 feet.
Yeah, it's not as good.
No. Nah. Yeah, it's a quarter mile.
Maybe 1K. Maybe you say 1K at a time.
Yeah.
I live my life 1K at a time.
Yeah, but technically, a drag strip's 1,000 feet now.
I saw I saw Fast Six in San Antonio on a Friday night at 10 o'clock p.m. With three friends of mine. And it was a theater that had like these stadium seating with the leather chairs that go back.
Yeah.
Really like one of those trick out theaters. I was so happy. But then some parents decided to bring all three of their kids.
Oh, no.
All under seven.
Oh, no.
We're interested in the movie. It's like midnight. They're running around the theater.
Yeah.
My friend Hershey's yelling at them. It was like that the Fast Six experience I wanted.
And the thing about Fast Six is it's so filled with nuance and tender, quiet moments that these kids could drag you right out of it, right out of the fantasy of the scene.
We're so fired up. I mean, it was the highlight of my week in San Antonio. I'm not even making it up. I'd been just saving it for the perfect night.
Yeah.
And it's about 10 minutes too long.
Yeah.
I still would give it a 13 or 14 out of 10.
Yeah. Yeah.
I loved it. I thought it had two of the best stunts I've ever seen. So we start out. First of all, this fit your, you love movies where they've already done the one last job.
Right.
But now it's time to do one last job.
Right.
It's like, didn't we just, we just tore up Brazil.
Right. Now.
And stole from drug dealers and whatever. And now we all went our merry ways. There should be no more jobs.
And also everyone's rich.
Yeah, really rich.
And the deal is you know, now they're going to be able to return to their crappy house in South Central. But half those people aren't even from L.A.
Right.
Why do they need to come back to the United States?
Well, we're going
to
hold that thought because we'll get into that at the end. I just thought, if I'm Paul Walker, I'm pretty happy, right? I just had a kid.
Right.
I'm living in anonymity in some tropical location with my wife.
Mm-hmm.
Who somehow lost all the baby weight, even though she said the kid, I mean, she weighed like 80 pounds.
It is funny, the beginning of the movie where Walker just has a kid, and the very beginning of the movie starts with Vin Diesel and Paul Walker going down a treacherous mountain road.
Yeah, they're just racing.
They're racing along a highway that if you miss one corner or you hit a late apex, you're going to plunge to your death. You're going to go down several thousand feet of rocky cliff into the ocean.
Good point.
And so they do 20 minutes of, you know, banging against each other and sliding around these corners on this treacherous mountain road. And then they get it. They get in the driveway and then Vin gives them the, "Your father now."
Right. Yeah.
You got to look out for yourself. How about you stop challenging me to these death races on this mountain road then? How long is this going to go on before you go off the side of the road she's a widow?
No more death-defying races.
All right. Now let's go back up to the devil's chair. Come on, I'll race you. Let's have a beer. Hold on. Let me drink a beer really weirdly. And then it's up to Pike's Peak. And seatbelts are for pussies. Yeah. Now let's go.
They're driving on the wrong side of the road.
I know.
Cars might be coming.
There could just be one cattle truck coming their direction. They're both dead.
You know what they always have in these movies? Because True Romance ended this way. And I think the last two Fast movies have had it. And a couple other ones. It's the guy's made it. And he's got the kid and the wife. And it's always got the scene where...
They always hear it's an acoustic flamenco guitar.
Yeah, yeah. It's happy music. And she's holding the baby. And he's like looking lovingly over.
Right.
I just want to say I've had two kids. I've never had a moment like that. It's usually like your wife's yelling at you because you forgot to get the diapers.
Yeah. No, the scene is...
What good are you? I do everything. Like, there's never that scene.
Oh, the scene is like, I'm going to stab you with this crocheting needle. If you don't shut up. I'm on the phone. That's the scene. Yeah,
you just woke the baby up again.
A lot of...
I'm still waiting for my beach scene with looking lovingly over my wife's shoulder.
My wife.
Because it's never happened.
My wife yelled at me once. She yelled at me. I'm raising these two kids alone. I said... Where are they now? They're at the park with the nanny. I said, well, are you raising right now alone? Who's paying the nanny? I'm raising these two kids alone. They're with the nanny while someone's raising them. That's great.
We could go all day on this.
I'm going to hire a guitar player.
Yeah.
You're going to stand next to
for kid number three,
and
if it happens.
And
we're
going to sit there. Oh, it's beautiful.
So everything's fine.
Mm-hmm.
Agent Hobbs, played by The Rock, a.k.a. Dwayne Johnson, who alternates between Dwayne The Rock Johnson, Dwayne Johnson, and The Rock Dwayne Johnson, or just The Rock. I feel like he has to pick at this point.
Well, I feel
just be
like...
The Rock. Nobody wants to call you Dwayne Johnson. You're The Rock.
He's like, you know, he's P. Diddy-esque in that
he just keeps changing his
that
name.
He has like three or four different handles, you know?
Right.
I love that guy.
I love him too. I thought he was great in this movie. I don't know if he would pass a lot of PED tests in the various sports.
Mm-hmm.
There might be some enhancement because his arms seem to be gaining size to the point that it's so he goes and he does the thing like, "You weren't hard to find, Toretto," and Dom goes, "Wasn't hiding."
Yeah, I love that. I love
which
that.
Which is great. That, right after he drank the beer, weirdly.
That's one of those moves, like in Rocky 3, you know, when, is it 3 when he said, "Go for it"?
Oh, yeah, Clubber Lang.
Clubber Lang's like,
"I'm going to mess you up."
Yeah. Well, no, what'd he say? Oh, whatever it was. And then he just went, "Go for it." And everyone made a big deal out of it. Like, that was on all the commercials and all that kind of. No, he said, "Prepare for pain" or something like that. And he went, "Go for it." And everyone went like, "Whoa."
Right.
But then it's not really a great line. Like when he goes, "You weren't hard to find, Toretta. Wasn't hiding." It's like, it's not that good a line, really, if you think of it. They made a meal out of, you know,
wasn't he wanted,
some
though?
Croutons. Yeah. He was
all
wanted.
These guys were on the top 20 FBI agent list. Hobbs, like, just immediately finds him.
Yeah, I don't know why he said he wasn't hiding.
So he shows him the picture of Letty.
Right.
Michelle Rodriguez.
Yeah.
Now, we had thought Letty died in Fast 4 because there was an accident. There were treadmarks. Dom was able to look at the treadmarks for 3 seconds. He found something, what did he find on the road?
Only
one person in LA could make it.
Nitro octane.
Right. Yeah. Found some nitro octane and realized immediately only one person only could make it. Also realized from the treadmarks, this was how she died.
Yeah.
It was amazing. It was like watching CSI.
He did that thing where, you know, they used to do in Westerns where the Indian would go ahead and then the pale face was smart enough to go like, "Hold up.
Right.
Leave him alone." Like, because then the guy'd take one knee and he'd put his hand in the soil and no one would ever go like, "Hey, running bear, what's up?" Like, "Shh, leave him alone."
And then
he'd do the thing where he'd do that and he'd look down the soil and he'd look up and he'd hear the hawk in the sky. Mm. Hawk in the sky. And then he'd walk back and he'd go, "Many men this direction," you know?
Yeah.
And then no one ever went like, "Well, how do you know?" Like, everyone just went like, "Okay."
So you're saying he's the Vindian.
Yeah, he's a Vindian.
Thank you.
Yeah, powerful.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
And he'd take the knee and he got down. It was nitromethane, by the way.
That's what it was. Yeah.
Nitromethane. And by the way, every funny car and every dragster for the last 50 years has run off of nitromethane. So it's not that scarce because everybody.
So you mean there's not only one place in LA that has it?
They would not be able to have the Winter Nationals at Pomona every year if they
could find it at Lowe's.
You probably find it at Lowe's. So
only one place has it except for 20 Lowe's.
He does the thing where he takes a knee, he puts his hand down like the Vindian. On the asphalt, he sniffs it, and then he closes his eyes.
Right.
And he sees everything that happened. I'm so jealous, because, like, I've tried that a couple times.
Yeah,
I just see a Charles in Charge rerun, like, nothing. Scott Baio standing there yelling with Willie Ames.
Heather Thomas is jumping up and down.
Nothing. I've done that thing where I've tried, and he envisions the entire crash to the point where he sees the guy with the crazy teeth.
Right.
Just put a cap.
Yeah. He sees everything.
And
as it turned out, he saw everything wrong because Letty's still alive.
Letty. Yeah.
So
I can I tell you, I was doing the Toyota Grand Prix this year, and Michelle Rodriguez was the
she's
only.
She's in the race?
Well, no. I cursed her and doomed me by going, "Who's in this race?" And it was a bunch of, "Never heard of this guy, never heard of that guy. Oh, this guy's a big country star." It's like, how can I never? Oh, this guy sells out soccer stadiums in Brazil. Really? I never heard of him. But Michelle Rodriguez is on there. And this was like 3 months before the movie came out. I knew she was back. So I'm
this is
good. So we went down to Willow Springs to do the training, and there she was. She's probably an instinctive actress, not the brightest. And I start talking to her about Letty. You know, I like when you're more interested than they are about their role.
Oh, that's, excuse me.
All right. And turns out she dropped out of the race. That's the only person I was interested in.
You freaked her out?
I don't know. I don't think it was me. She had a couple of practices. I think she's a not a very disciplined person.
Oh.
That's my take on her. I liked her.
She was
good.
Disciplined enough to grab that Fast Six money.
Yeah.
Now, the problem is Vin Diesel met that Brazilian widow in Fast Five, the cop.
Yeah.
And in Fast Six starts out right before he weirdly drinks the beer. They're kind of getting it on and they're together. They're a couple.
Mm-hmm.
Just ditches her completely for Letty.
Mm.
And then at the end, it all comes full circle after.
There's some,
by the way, we're going to spoil this movie. So if you haven't seen it, stop listening.
Something I've learned, when you live near the ocean, you can only have sex during the day. You know, when you live like inland.
In a movie or in real life?
I think it may be real life. Only movies, I know. That much I know. But like, I live in the valley, so I got to have sex after the streetlights come on.
Yeah.
But when you live near the ocean, the window's always open. There's always a curtain thing, and they're always laying there on top of the sheets like they just did it. But it's always the afternoon delight.
Well, she gave
they
up
don't
her,
do it at night.
She gave up her career for Vin.
I know. And
then at the end of the movie, after they get, spoiler alert coming from now on, after they get Lady back and bring her to the other side.
Yeah.
The girl comes back and you're like, oh, this will be good. She'll be like, you asshole. You're going back there. She's like, this is your family and this is mine. It holds her badge.
She did the thing, too, where she was like, she was still in a refractory period when she told Vin, like, hey, I understand. You go have sex with someone else. Like, I don't know many women who do that. Like,
how about this? I don't know any woman who would do that.
If I said to my wife, hey, remember Sharon, my old girlfriend? Yeah. Well, she just got divorced. So it turns out she's freed up. So I'm thinking about kind of heading that direction for a while. She wouldn't be like, oh, you got to go do what you got to do.
I thought they made a huge mistake. I would have had her be a little bit upset and maybe even hinted that there's going to be some revenge in Fast 7.
Yeah,
open that door. She's like, oh, your family, you guys belong together. It's like, you just gave up your career pulled off this heist to live with Vin Diesel in luxury.
Clearly not in love with Vin. Like, they didn't make that clear, the reality is, if she was deeply into Vin, she would have been like, well, how do you know this picture wasn't doctored? And screw that bitch.
That's
true.
Right.
Like, she was like,
she was always so mean to you, I thought.
Like, yeah, go do what you got to do.
Yeah.
So he goes to do.
He goes, what so he gets the do. Band back together.
Right.
The only problem, maybe she should have gotten together with The Rock at the end of Fast Six. Is The Rock supposed to be asexual in these movies? He never wants to take a crack at anybody.
It's weird. You know, he's married to his job.
Oh, he's one of those. He's married to his job and his body butter.
Yeah, he's married to carnauba butter and his job. I think that's that. And then they They get the band back together.
Which is great.
They always have that.
Everybody drops what they're doing immediately. They're in chartered jets. They're turning them around, doing that.
Yeah. That part never rings true to me.
So they're.
I don't think I could ever do that with anybody.
The target was, in the words of The Rock, a team of highly coordinated drivers took down a military convoy.
Mm-hmm.
Rock needs Dom's help. His target's Owen Shaw.
Right.
They have the line a bit later. It's like they're hunting their evil twins.
I like when they do that move where they go, you know, what about the police? What about the military? These guys are too good. You know, it's like,
really? They're too good for our military?
Yeah, it scares me now that our military is so inept.
We spent 5-6 years training Green Berets, but like the freaking Vin Diesel in his spare time is our best option.
Yeah, and the SEAL Team 6, I feel like they could get it done, but they got to get the team back together. This idea that the guy's an amazing driver, it goes back. It's a weird thing because it started off before there was like helicopters and radar and satellite and like radar and all that kind of stuff. And it'd be like, you know, playing banjo music and a guy on a dirt road, you know, and they just robbed the bank and it's the 30s and they're going to outrun the local cops. And then the local cops, they don't have a helicopter and they don't have a radio to tell the next cops. And it sort of made sense.
But not in
2013. They'll have these movies where the guy's like in the middle of L.A. and he's like, this guy's the best driver in the world. And he's got to outdrive. And it's like, you can outdrive anyone on the LAPD, but you can't outdrive the helicopter
No.
or whoever if you're going to Simi Valley, those guys get on the radio and go, hey, Simi Valley, this guy's coming your way. And thus, it's kind of null and void, but we've hung on to it, which I do appreciate.
What would you do if you were being chased by the LAPD? I watch these car chases sometimes. And don't you always end up thinking about what you would do in this situation?
Yeah.
When you would give up, how far you'd go? I would drive right to LAX. Because the helicopters can't go into the space.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I would go right into LAX.
Somebody did that.
Into the parking garage. And then just try to blend in with everybody else. That's the move.
Somebody
did
that.
Why don't these people do that? Did it work?
Well, it worked for the helicopter part, but not for the rest. Because LAX is lousy with cops. You know what I mean? They're all right. Kind of hanging out there. So I would probably take... I would just use... What I would do is I would probably stretch out my 15 minutes of fame as much as humanly
possible.
Try to
be on TV for as long as you could?
I would just get like... Some lipstick and write backwards fundanything.com/Adam Carolla like
road hard.
Road hard on my
good
windshield
idea.
And just keep circling and just because they're not going to
don't throw this idea
or
out.
Anything.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah. So, and by the way, first time offense, you know.
Yeah, you might get off 6 months probation.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And you just get as much camera time
just don't
as
hit anybody during
humanly
the chase.
Possible.
Yeah.
Nah, I'm a good driver.
I'll
be fine. So, all right. They get the team back together.
Yes.
And now they got to go after these international guys.
The only problem is The Rock had a new partner, and it was like the producers had a meeting and said, Jordana Brewster might be one of the 5 worst actresses on the planet. Who can we get that's worse than her?
Right.
What about MMA star Gina Carano?
Right, yeah.
I mean, she was bad.
Yeah.
I don't know if they did that intentionally, but I'm pretty sure I would have gone another direction.
Well, the fundamental problem with these... movies where they go, this guy's an MMA star, so we're going to take like Randy Couture and we're going to put him in.
And then all the MMA guys will come.
And the Expendables or whatever. It's like, yeah, but in the movie, you have a fight, a stunt coordinator, and it's choreographed, all that kind of stuff. So you don't really need Randy Couture doing the fighting because Sly Stallone can do the fighting because it's fake fighting. You need Randy. What you need Randy Couture for is if a Teamster gets drunk and comes at you on set, then Randy Couture starts paying dividends.
Then he chokes him out.
Other than that, you have the guy who's doing fake fighting and bad acting, like real bad acting and then fake fighting.
Well, so...
Yeah, she was...
So the gang demands pardons.
Right. Yeah, they want pardons.
And Rock's unclear on it. And unfortunately, I was going to go see it this week, and I couldn't because I was on kid duty. But Vince says something like, I've been part of my whole life. Like, that's how it ends the discussion. Do you remember what he says?
Yeah.
Something like that. It was a good line. It was good diesel.
There's also the thing where somehow The Rock is vested with authority that even the president and the
good
Congress like, don't have, you know, where they go like, you know, like we want freedom. We want amnesty for everyone.
We'll be pardoned for all our crimes.
We'll be pardoned for all our crimes. And we want this nonsense in Darfur to come to an end. And then The Rock's like, no can do. And he's like, listen, I want clean, drinkable water for every person on the planet, and I want to have college tuition for everyone in every part of Asia and Africa. And then he goes, all right, you got it. And it's like, I don't know, don't you have to make a phone call?
Hey, you think Rockovic, just hold on 1 second.
Rock would never go like, hey, man, I could get in a lot of trouble.
Yeah.
Like, I went cowboy before, and I got hollered at.
Rock's just dipping body butter in his arms. Like, all right, that all sounds good. All right.
Yeah,
so they go, and they go to find him. Couple good scenes, couple good chase scenes. They nice little Gina Carano-Letty fight scene in the trolley, which I enjoyed.
Right, that was good.
Nothing on the level of The Rock versus Vin Diesel in Fast Five, that fight scene, which...
We're like throwing people through walls and that
I think
kind of stuff.
That fight scene was incredible. I forgot how good that was. I think that might be the single best moment in any of the Fasts.
Yeah, it was a great scene.
Really good. I'm surprised The Rock kind of rolled over for Vin at the end.
Right.
Because you walk away from that fight scene thinking like... Yeah, Vin Diesel kind of, I give that round 10-9 to Vin.
Right.
And The Rock's like a foot taller than him.
Yeah.
And every scene they have to shoot with them, it's always they're looking up at them. Because Vin's what, 5'6"?
Yeah, he's short and The Rock's
and The Rock's
6'5".
Former football player. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah,
you have to do trick photography just to make it look
they
like
they're
remotely. They
have to just dig a hole and The Rock has to just stand in the hole and have him talk to Vin. And yeah, that was a great fight scene. And then the cool car, let's not forget the technology.
Oh, which one was that?
The wedge that would flip all the cars.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
They
that
were
was
driving
great.
Those crazy sand rails that had the wedge thing that were like just sliding under all the cars and flipping them.
That was a
innovative piece of technology. Like the dude who thought of that for that movie, the ectoskeleton sand rail wedge car where you could hit a car coming at you at full speed straight ahead and just slide right over the top of you and flip it.
Great idea.
Great
idea. That
was
what the villain, Owen, whatever his name was driving. But
yeah,
it made me think like that should at least be in a video game.
When did
Grand Theft Auto 5 should have that.
When do these villains get so easy on the eyes? Like, they're really taking care of themselves. You know, they used,
very
to, have,
handsome
they used
villains.
To have huge scars.
Yeah, yeah, very
like,
handsome.
They'd be mauled or mangled.
Fish eye.
Yeah, like crazy eye. They'd just be fat and petting a cat the whole time. Or they had a cane. You know, they're like cripples. Now these guys are doing like Pilates every morning for 2 hours. Like, they're incredible. They don't drink. They don't smoke. Like,
right.
The villains used to like be, oh, I have a cigarette, like have a gnarled hand and one ear that'd been bitten off, you know.
Or they'd be super smart, like the guy from Die Hard.
Yeah.
They'd be like this mastermind.
Now they're all super good looking. They don't drink. They don't smoke. They don't do any, you
That's
know.
A great point.
They don't really... Outside of trying to destroy the world, they're really, you know, model citizens.
Dom had a couple good quotes.
Mm-hmm.
When they're debating about going back for Letty or not, he tells Paul Walker, "You don't turn your back on family, even when they do." First of all, I don't know what that means.
I don't know what it means
but
either.
They've turned their back on you, but you still can't turn your back on family?
Listen, if I called my sister today and she said, "Never call here again."
Yeah, I hate you.
I hate you. Never call me again. I'd be like, all right. Well, that's one person won't be borrowing money.
We also had...
But if she wanted to call me, you know, I'd pick up the phone.
Maybe that's what Dom was trying to say.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I don't... And then, you know, I feel like I wouldn't need to go after Letty, but then... It's what, well, we don't want to get... I don't want to jump the gun with what Letty did to Dom, but that was...
Well, then the other one he had was Ride or Die, which I enjoyed.
Die. Right.
I thought Vin was incredible in this movie. He's also, he's aging nicely. Like he's getting smaller and older looking, but is fighting it.
Yeah.
And to the point where I just really enjoy every time he's on the screen. It reminds me a little of Stallone in the mid 90s, like a little like after Cliffhanger where the aging process is really starting to set in, but he just wasn't admitting it and was still wearing the same tank tops and all that stuff. But so we had in the middle of all this, and I'm convinced that this is what happened. Paul Walker has to break back into jail to get information, which is another one of your favorite plots.
It is, because
when the guy has to break back in, but if you go in,
you're on your own.
You're on your own.
Right.
If anything happens, we can't let anybody know that we knew this.
If there was a key in cell block 7 that would unlock some door that would solve all this problem, then I would say, like, go back. But he's just going back to talk to Mendoza.
Right.
Who has been just avoiding being gang raped for the last 4 years. Like, he doesn't know anything that's going on in the outside world. Sure. So he's just going to go talk to Mendoza.
Or he's been gang raping.
Right. Yeah. More likely, Mendoza is more of a leader. And so he's going to go talk to him, and he's going to fly back to L.A.
Yeah.
And... they're in, I don't know, London or Prague or something at this point. And see, there's never this scene. There's never, I would always be going like, I've had this conversation with my wife a million times where she's like, I'm going out tonight and I'm getting eggs because the kids don't have. And I'll go, oh, let them eat cereal in the morning. And then she'll go, I just should get that because we need milk too. And I'll go, don't go out tonight. You're in your bathrobe.
Right.
I'd just be the guy going, you're going to fly back to L.A.
This is crazy.
You're going into prison.
It's a 14-hour
flight.
You're
probably never going to get out of prison.
Yeah.
There's no way they're going to let you in. And then what are the chances you find Mendoza? And then when you do, you think he's going to tell you anything? And
this is all with the director. I think told Paul Walker. Paul Walker's like, no, you promised I'd get my own scene.
Right.
So he gets like his little 6-minute scene. He gets to have his little prison fight, all that stuff.
How stoked was the guy from Fast and Furious 1 when his phone rang after 11 years going, hey, what are you up to? And he's
the
like,
the bearded guy?
The guy Paul Walker punched.
Oh, that guy. Yeah.
That guy had to be like, who's this? It's the producer from Fast and Furious.
What?
Yeah.
I'm filming a TV movie with Jimmy Smits.
Yeah, it's a Lifetime movie. Yeah. And he had to be like, we just took the last five off and now you want me back?
I'm in.
I mean,
just tell me when and where.
Oh, my God.
Are you paying me in cash?
Oh, my God.
So then we have this leads to the tank scene was fantastic.
Yeah.
And had an unbelievable stunt that got gasps and applause in the theater I was in when Letty ends up jumping from the car. Vin sees her the other way. He jumps. He catches her in midair. Great CGI.
Yeah.
I liked it. I enjoyed everything about it.
And the tank was great.
Tank was great.
And, you know, the part where they went, we've been compromised. We're not safe inside of Fort Knox.
Yeah.
We gotta take the key fob and move it out of here. Like, I would argue that just the one guy, lower ranking guy, it turned out was with the other guys. I'd still would have left. Mm. I would argue to leave the thing there and not go on the convoy. But, you know.
Hey, they needed to have the convoy, though.
They went on the convoy.
We needed a convoy. And then we needed the 35-mile airport runway for the climactic scene.
Oh, my God. Hey, well, first off.
It's been discussed on the internet ad nauseum, so we don't want to add on to it.
Jumping
too much,
from car to car.
I was going to ask, how hard is that to do?
I don't know, because no one's ever tried it in real life, but in movies, it happens a lot.
A lot.
And I don't feel like I'd ever have that kind of coordination, like, first off, there'd be a long conversation if I was driving with my wife and I said, all right, I'm going to need you to take the wheel. She'd be like, what? I need you to take the wheel. Whose wheel? The wheel. I'm going to climb out of the sunroom.
Like, keep this straight.
No, you're not. Yeah. Like, I don't feel like there'd be immediate, you know, like in movies, they turn to the person and go, I need you to take the wheel. I'm climbing out of the sunroof. They go, gotcha. And they start sliding over. Like, halfway into, I need you to take the wheel. The person's already switching seats with them. I would need much more in-depth conversation about why I needed to take the wheel, why we couldn't perhaps pull over.
The next time we're driving to Vegas, just ask me mid-drive to take the wheel, and I'll just instinctively grab
start
it.
Start switching.
Just start climbing out the window.
Yeah.
It is true. It is the percentage of people jumping from car to car and actually pulling it off.
Yeah,
is 100%.
Yeah,
nobody's ever like, oh, I jumped wrong. Oh, yeah, I clipped my foot.
Yeah, they never miss.
Yeah,
so they jump from car to car, no problem. And then there's also this thing: if we're at the never ending,
the longest airport runway ever.
the part where they're fighting and they're just, you know, the runway never ends and the movie never ends.
The fight, the 2-on-2 fight was fantastic, though.
Yeah, that's
Rock and Vin Diesel versus the two bad guys.
Yeah.
But probably one of the best fight scenes they've had.
Yeah.
Ends up with the Road Warriors, like, clothesline.
Yeah.
Where Rock throws Vin Diesel, and I love that.
Yeah, that was good stuff. Then there's the part where the Asian guy and his girl, I mean, somebody had to get burned. And
I wouldn't have picked the hottest girl in the movie.
I would have kept her. But that part where, and I don't think this can't happen, or if it did, it'd be a good thing to use in like the MMA.
Mm.
And here's I'm talking about the strategy. You're fighting it out with this dude, and he's an equal foe, and you're going back and forth and back and forth, and then all of a sudden, he throws your old lady off the car, and you see she's clearly gone. You know, she's dead. And then you see that, and you go, huh? And now you pick him up, and you throw him into the intake of the jet engine, and he's evaporated. I don't feel like it would work that way. Like if you were in the octagon, and you were fighting, and you were just, like, fighting it out, and all of a sudden somebody went like, hey, and they showed your wife offside, and somebody smacked your wife, you wouldn't go, huh? What? And then you would just take John Bones Jones and just turn him into a pretzel.
He'd probably be rattled.
Yeah, you'd be more screwed up. And then as soon as he saw his girlfriend was gone, boom, right into the intake of the jet engine.
It was pretty good. Great fight scenes. The runway, I feel like it was intentional. I think they do these movies with a little wink-wink.
Mm-hmm.
And they knew, like, at some point somebody was like, do you think people are going to notice that this runway was long? And they were like, oh, let's make it longer.
Right.
Screw it.
Yeah.
Screw those people.
Yeah, why not?
And yeah. People will talk about it. They'll have little internet sites devoted to how long the runway. People try to figure out exactly how many miles. Like, they do all that stuff intentionally.
And there's nothing better. I don't think there's been a movie that involved like a huge Russian transport plane that I disliked. Like, it was always
great.
Whatever goes on side. Con Air had that.
Yeah.
They had the, the Kuzak movie about the end of the world, about 4 or 5 years old. That was excellent. Had the giant transporter in it with all the cars in it. There's like three of those movies that came out where the polar caps were melting and blah, blah, blah.
Oh, but yeah. I know what you're talking about.
This was the Mayan calendar.
Yeah.
Kuzak movie. Everyone at home screaming
2012 or whatever.
Yeah.
Oh, we got a roll soon.
Oh, okay.
So anyway, it ends with to get rid of the bad guys.
Well, it was kind of poetic.
Did you believe the cars could have pulled down the plane? Could two race cars pull down a plane that's trying to take off? I had a mild problem with that.
Well, they dragged a full-size safe through Brazil.
I felt like the safe was more probable than
yeah.
A plane, then, I feel like, could take off. It'd be like, I'd just take the cars with it.
And what about the button at the end?
Oh, yeah, so... Oh. Yeah. Which one? The Asian guy?
The Asian guy. Yeah, because Tokyo Drift was like a prequel. Someone was trying to explain this to me once. I never really.
It was a prequel?
Yeah. Because remember at the end of Fast Five when he was sitting there driving the Lexus and she was like on his lap and they're like, where do you want to go? I don't know. How about Tokyo? Like you were supposed to know what that meant. Tokyo Drift was supposed to be, he was in that right. one. And that was like not a prequel. I don't know. It took place before all this. I got to eat a pot brownie.
Now we're in like
fetal
the
position.
It's like the Terminator where you're like, well, he came back, but then he had the kid
but he lost his gal. And, he got a bullet in him.
And my friend Chen, who's friends with the director, thinks that his theory is that because the director, Justin Lin, isn't directing Fast 7,
mm-hmm.
that he killed off the Asian guy who was like his character proxy.
Mm.
And it was like a symbolic killing off,
which I like.
I'm a proponent of that
theory.
There's
a prequel thing. Someone will they'll tell you online how it goes. But then we had, what's his name, introduced into the movie? Statham, Jason Statham.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Great idea. Keep adding A-listers.
That's right.
It's a great idea. Really smart.
Now, who's Statham? Like, what's he going to do? What side's he going to be
on? We didn't mention the dumbest part of the movie, which I really resented, which was that after all of this, like, what do you want, Rock? Or what do you want, Vin? Or Dom?
Mm-hmm.
And Dom's like, I want to go back to 287 or whatever. Like,
right.
And we're like, what's 287? It's like, oh, it's that house he has.
Dilapidated piece of crap with no air
conditioning. Lower middle class house in L.A.
South Central. Yeah,
where y'all started. You want to go back there.
Area. Yeah.
That's what you're going to do with your $20 million that you just made?
Yeah.
You're going to go back to your first
house?
Well,
that's the point.
Who would do that?
You're not. Well, you wouldn't.
You know why?
You don't have the character of Dom.
Because he had to have a cookout.
Right.
It's the obligatory cookout scene.
Yeah.
But they were missing the little speech at the end where him and Paul Walker, they always have the speech where he's like, tell me about your mother.
Yeah, he's just very family oriented for a guy who just boosts cars and kills people. It's quite a dichotomy.
His life revolves around Nas, but somehow.
Right. Yeah. And
somehow doesn't want to have kids. He's all about family, but has no interest in siring more Doms.
Yeah, where are
there's
the,
no Dom
there's
Jr.
little Doms rolling around.
Yeah.
And Statham was the transporter.
I love the Statham edition.
So he knows his way around an Audi. I mean, he's driven cars. He was the transporter.
Miami Vice could have been on for 20 years had they kept adding characters.
Right.
And then they never added anyone new, and the show is dead in 4 years.
Mm-hmm.
Fast and Furious is smart. They keep adding pieces.
Right.
You move fringe pieces out. You add new pieces in.
It is.
That's what you do with
a
franchise.
It's a four-wheeled gin rummy hand.
So what's your final?
Discard and add.
What's your final grade?
I think I liked five a little bit better.
I did too.
Because
I thought five was the pinnacle of this
pinnacle
franchise.
Better, but if I was to put these things together, I would say let's see, fours where they went into Mexico. Yeah, Tokyo Drift's at the bottom. The power rankings would be five at the top, six, one.
I'd go 5-1-6-4-2-3.
Either way. My next, whenever they ask me, because I'm getting so confused now, where you have to sign up for something and they need a code for everything, like they need an access code for everything, I'm going to do the power rankings of Fast and Furious, and that way I'll never forget it. Because now, sometimes I do my dog's name, sometimes I do my daughter's name, I'm always confused.
5-6-1-4-2-3.
Well, you'd never forget it, would you? And if you messed it up once, you wouldn't mess it up the second time. Maybe you swap two and three.
All right. So if you want to help fund Adam Carolla's movie Road Hard, you go to fundanything.com/Adam Carolla. And if you want to, if you're in LA and you want to go to the Wiltern on Los Angeles, August 3rd, concerts.livenation.com. Check that out. August 3rd, the Wiltern.
Love you, Bill.
Adam Carolla. Next time we'll do Liam Neeson movies.
Yeah. Awesome.
Pleasure as always.
Target to sign off.
Thank you for downloading the BS Report with Bill Simmons.
Too much fun.
Check out more podcasts at the iTunes Music Store or at Podcenter at ESPNRadio.com.
Peace out.